deserve. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for another day. For this is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Father, we ask your presence into this building today and within these walls. Bless and guide our coaches, those on their way, and those within these walls. Bless them, guide them, help them to move forward with all that they plan to do this year and in other years. Those that are not here, we ask that you comfort their families and their friends. Bless us today, bless the evening. We ask that your presence be in it and fill it as we walk in your steps, as leaders, as you taught us to. These we ask in your precious name. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Bora. And now we'll invite Mr. Garth Gale, the president of the Jamaica Athletics Administrative Association, to bring greetings. Mr. Gale.
Thank you very much. Good night to each member present here. And it's indeed a pleasure. Coaches and Olympians and our guest speaker, Dr. Gregory Orton. It's indeed, I'm looking forward to hear your address. It was just recently that the Coaches Association had their recent awards, and we're back here again. This occasion is a very simple but very important one, because to recognize the service of those who have given so many years to our sport, you know, really and truly, it is a good deed that the Jamaica Coaches Association is doing tonight. If I'm a little off, it's because I've been doing so many activities today. This is my fourth activity for today. And so I think it's very simple for me to welcome so many friends. I don't want to start to call names. Receiving awards for the various categories. I thought the room would have been filled and persons outside wanting to find space inside. But alas, I wonder why that is so. But for those who are here, welcome. And your service, your duty to track and field is being recognized tonight. So once again, I want to welcome you all. And on behalf of the J3s, it is indeed our pleasure. We will continue to play our part in, along with the Coaches Association of Jamaica, each year at this annual function. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gale. Well, I'm not seeing the minister anywhere, so. Okay, well, hopefully her representative will come along, and at that time we'll invite him or her to bring greetings from the Minister of Sport. Ladies and gentlemen, we are honored to have a distinguished speaker and one of our own bring tonight's keynote address. He has a long string of accomplishments, including, but not limited to, because we don't have all night, world champion, Commonwealth champion, multiple Olympic medalist, who can forget the famous Pupalik, Goodwill Games champion, two-time Pan American champion, two-time Central and America champion, five-time Jamaica national champion, 13-time All-American honors. In 1997, he was inducted in the Virginia Sports Hall of Fame. In 2001, he was inducted in the George Mason University Hall of Fame. And he is the 1999-2000 Carrera Sports Foundation Male Athlete of the Year. The Excelsior High School alum utilizes his vast athletic and academic experience and knowledge to assist individuals in achieving their highest career potential. Our guest speaker holds a PhD in business management from North Central University. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Dr. Gregory Horton.
Coaches, athletes, administrators, and guests. I must say a special thanks to Coach David Riley for extending this invitation. My brother, this invitation is greatly appreciated. It is an immense honor to be given the opportunity to speak here to acknowledge all the awardees tonight. They truly deserve this recognition. Today, it is my pleasure to wish the coaches my most sincere congratulations for the hard work and sacrifices they have made to advance their athletes, the affiliated administration, your family, and your country. I, Dr. Gregory Horton, take my hat off and salute you. To the sponsors who have invested their money to ensure that both athletes and esteemed coaches are provided with the needed resources to make their dream a reality. Today, I am sure you are feeling overjoyed to know that your investments have made a difference in the lives of so many. And I am sure your contributions are cherished. So keep the support coming. The coaches need it. To the physical therapists and weight trainers who work closely with the coaches, lending your expertise to ensure that these athletes are healthy and ready to produce great performances. I must say your acknowledgement is cemented in all the great achievements for the world to see. Again, I take my hat off and salute the coaches who are here to be recognized for the accomplishments tonight. You have worked tirelessly and diligently to make this day a reality. You have earned it. You have sacrificed sleep. You have sacrificed your time. You have sacrificed being away from your families, all in an effort to make your dream a reality. Coaches, I was looking forward to talking to more of you face to face. But today is your day, and by right, your hard work and commitment to your athletes and your country is being recognized here tonight. Only you know the challenges you have faced to get here, to be able to collect some of these awards. No one knows the rivers you had to cross, the mountains you had to climb, and even the insults you had to endure to get to where you currently are today. You see, believe me, I am aware of the indispensable value of a true coach. And when I look back at my time as an athlete, I wished and I used to pray that I had a coach who was able to teach me some of the things that I needed to know to be a great athlete. Now, I am going to share a story with you, and I hope the coaches who are here tonight, that they will open their minds and they will get the message from what I am trying to share here tonight. Believe it or not, the fourth time I tried out for my track team, my coach thought I was not good enough. And as a result of that, he made me try out in the rain. To make it worse, the field was red, wet, and muddy. And for the coaches who are here, they would know that most of the athletes, including myself, I did not have the proper running shoe. And as a result, that is why I had to run barefoot. And for those who know as well that for me, if I try to use my one pair of Gator sneakers to run that time trial in and come home with some mud, my mother would have killed me.
So while I was going through this situation in my mind as a 16-year-old athlete, I was saying to myself that this is just too much for me. And I started to tell myself that I don't think I wanted this opportunity that bad. But then I had an instant flashback of where I lived and where I wanted to be. You see, growing up in Seaview Gardens, I had to have a determined mindset to welcome challenges, even if I was not prepared. And therefore, racing against time barefoot on a muddy surface was something I had to do to prove to this coach that I deserved an opportunity. A minute, I thought about my mother, and then I thought about my siblings who were also in Seaview Garden facing dire poverty. And that inspired me to press on. You see, when I sat down and I thought about the price that I was going to pay to be great, winning was never an option. And I will continue with the story. I ran my heart out that day. I thought I did well. After the race, the coach came and said, "Youth man, you have potential." I was on the team only on a temporary basis. And even though I knew the coach did not want me out there, I showed up for practice every single day. Why did I show up for practice every single day? Because I was hungry for success. And I knew I had to be disciplined for the cause. I eventually convinced him I was an asset, and eventually I made the team. But soon I was put to the test again. I was summoned to compete in an event that I had no experience in. The coach was sure that I would underperform that day. And even though I didn't win the race that day, the outcome was very surprising to him, further proving him that he was wrong about me. And the history books is here to speak on behalf of myself. I gave you a little snapshot of my story to say that when I look at the function of a true coach, it is to build champions and not to break the spirit of the young athletes. Trust me, many youths would have crumbled and quit under the pressure, but no, not I. Coaches, wherever you are on your journey to greatness, please listen keenly. The primary responsibility of a true coach is to ensure that the athlete falls in love with the idea of becoming a champion first, long before the actual reality occurs. All true coaches know that as a man thinketh, so he doeth. Winning begins in the athlete's mind. With talent and good coaching, whatever the mind conceives and believes, it can be achieved. I remember as a 19-year-old, it was my first world championship experience at Stuttgart. And I remember two of the guys that finished in the top three did not have the qualifying time. So fortunate for me, I was able to run for my country. And I remember after going through the first round, very tough, inexperienced, very nervous, not sure how to deal with success. And the head coach for the team, Mr. Mike Olivier, he said, he was just encouraging me and supporting me throughout the ordeal. When I made it to the final and he saw the attention that I was getting, he brought me into his room and shut me off from both good and bad influence because he wanted me to focus on what was most important to me. So I'm just taking the time now to say thank you, Coach Mike Olivier, wherever you are in the world. You have helped in the development and the shaping of a champion. The second responsibility of a true coach is to help to build the confidence of the athletes. I said it earlier, and I will say it again. Not crushing the spirit of the youth is of utmost importance when building champions. All true coach should be understanding and patient with their athletes. This is the level where physical, emotional, and psychological development is needed the most. Now, 2 years after Stuttgart, I was much more stronger, much more emotionally stable, and much more psychologically ready to take on the world. So in 1995 in Sweden, I was one of the favorite to finish in the top three. I remember I took it on with pleasure because I was at a phase in my life where I could do more for myself, my family, and my country. So I used to walk around all the time and try to hang out with coaches like Mr. Glenn Mills and Mr. Fitz Coleman, because I wanted to know all that they knew. because I knew that the difference between a winner and a loser was the information that you embrace and use it on the track. The third responsibility of a true coach is to help the athlete to keep a strong focus on the task or the event at hand. Mental strength and mental stamina is what separates good athletes from great athletes. And I can tell you, during my ordeal, especially in the 2000 Olympics, I was going through a lot. Yes, I was going through a lot. If you guys look at the race, you will see me punching my chest because I was saying to myself, I am going to conquer this moment. This is my time. And I would do everything in order to achieve my goal. The fourth responsibility of a true coach is to keep the athlete motivated and inspired, transforming their aspirations into reality as they develop. I've always said that coaches are overwhelmed. And as a result of that, sometimes they are not able to do everything on their own. So they need to ensure that their athletes have mentors and psychologists who can help them to see the bigger picture. I believe that together we are better. And I know that sometimes we all want to take the victory lap by ourselves. And I'm saying here today, Coach Riley, I appreciate what you're doing, because with the body of coaches here and willing to work together, we can achieve a whole lot. I've said it over and over. The information that the coaches have today, it must be passed on to the grassroots coaches. I also want to say that the coaches, another responsibility of the coach, is to make sure that the athletes do the right things the right way, at the right time, in the right sequence. Because when you talk to coaches like Frano, Stephen Francis, he's telling you that execution is everything. I'll close now. Another responsibility of the coach is to maintain a supportive and a professional relationship at all times when it comes to the athlete. And to deviate from this principle is very counterproductive and detrimental to the coach's reputation. Our young athletes are the future, so we must protect them, we must guide them, and we must ensure that they are kept healthy as humanly possible all the time. The athletes are counting on us, the elders, to pave the way and steer them in the right direction. If we fail, then we are leading this next generation off course. If the athletes are to develop to become successful in the sport, then their growth and development must be the ultimate priority. I will close by saying this today, that we can all agree that there is no great athlete without a great coach. Raw talent needs to be refined, and a great coach has a tool to make sure that the raw talent is sharpened like a double-edged sword, cutting through the wind with every great performance. So today, coaches, even though many of you are not here to hear what I have to say, I'm sure you'll see it on TVJ and other sports agent, because getting this information is vital to your growth and your development. So again, I just want to take my hat off and salute the coaches and let you know that we appreciate you, even though sometimes it seems like we don't care. But you too must play a vital role if Jamaica is to continue the dominance for the next 20 and 50 years. I thank you all for listening to me. I hope that we will continue to work together in every different capacity, because I've said it many a times. My aim is to pass on the information and the knowledge that I garnered over the years, because the last thing I would want to do is to transition into the next world with all the knowledge and information that I've garnered over the years. I thank you all for listening. May God continue to bless and keep you all safe.
Keep the applause going, ladies and gentlemen. You're never too old to learn, and they say even a child shall lead them. And I know what many of you knew Dr. Horton as a child, as an athlete, as a youngster, competing for his family, his country, his school, and so on. So thank you very much, Dr. Horton, for such an inspirational address. And I can guarantee you that one TVJ will ensure that some of the coaches who are not here will at least get to hear some of what you had to say. So thank you so much. All right, before we go into the awards, we're gonna break for dinner. All right, so sit back, relax, fellowship with each other, you know, laugh, chat, catch up as we dine. See you in a bit.
Thank you.
And congratulations on being awarded tonight. I want to first ask you about your role at Edwin Allen, taking the school from obscurity, really, into the powerhouse of a school that is now, in those years of coaching that you have, you know, under your belt.
Well, thanks for having me here. My role at Edwin Allen has been very challenging in the initial. It was very challenging in the initial stage, you know. So I had to build from the grassroots, as I said, to the powerhouse that we have become at this point in time. You know, but it really took a lot of hard work, dedication and discipline, and teamwork as well, because I had to get a good team in place to provide all the necessary expertise and assistance to make, you know, our team what it is at this point in time. And support all around. One of the important things is that you need to get your administrations bind to whatever you are doing. So once they are on board with you, then you know you can move the school and get the students interested in whatever you have to offer to make sure that you know we achieve success in the end. So at this point in time, I must say I am very pleased where we are currently and you know from where we are coming from to this point in time. Well, you know, winning is always, I would say it's everybody's, you know, hope or dream to win a title. And winning, especially the girls' championship title, was no easy feat. You know, you had to, as they would say, blood, sweat, and tears, through those rain and, as Dr. Gregory mentioned, in terms of the muddy field and all of that. But, you know, those challenges will come when you are building champions. So it wasn't easy, but, you know, we work hard. We have suffered many defeats before becoming a champion. So when you get there, you want to stay there. It is sweet. Well, I must really commend the Jamaica Track and Field Association for, you know, recognizing the work that we have been doing as coaches. You know, because it is nothing easy. We are everything in an athlete's life. You know, parents, teachers, coaches, you name them all. We play those roles. So, you know, in recognizing us, I believe it is a step in the right direction. And I wish more persons would have been here, you know, probably some unavoidable. But it is really something that, you know, we will continue to look forward to, because sometimes you're probably watching the media, the news, and you would have seen other persons being rewarded. Or, you know, especially when you have the national award ceremony. So it was, I believe it was a really great thing to have the coaches award, and I am truly appreciative of this opportunity to be here tonight.
Thank you very much, and have a wonderful evening, and congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Platinum awardee. Mm-hmm. And just a reminder, our platinum awardees, they have served in the coaching profession for 30 to 40 years. So a precious metal, platinum, and it's some precious years. So you've been in the game for a long time.
Yes, I have been into the game for the age from the age of 17 years old, and this award to me is more than pocket money. I was looking forward for this for many years, and now is the time for it. I appreciate so much.
Yes, I guess I don't have to ask you what it means to you, because you clearly have said it.
Yeah.
So, what have those years been like for you?
In coaching, on the whole, it has been good and bad. It's a ups and down for the kids at primary level. You understand? And it's a pleasure working with them. You understand, there are times, there are good times, bad times, rough times, but one of the most important things in my training at all times, I always deal with the big D, discipline. And apart from discipline, you have to work hard. I don't do the friendship with parents in my training. Okay? No friend. If you can't manage your work, go. Yeah.
So, what would you? What is one thing that stands out for you? Something memorable over the years?
One of the most important, the thing that stands out most of all for me, is just seeing the kids out there performing. Most coaches out there is a win thing for them. I'm not like that, right? For instance, talent, I can work with it and go on to higher levels. That is the most important thing for me. Because I have guys out there who have performed like the Jermaine Mason, came from my hand, the Jermaine Barkley. I can name a lot. I can name them, okay? You understand? But the most important thing for me is talent. So they can go on and be a better person, book-wise, athletics wise.
Okay, thank you. And lastly, I want to know what would you say to a young coach just entering the profession?
What I would say to a young coach who just coming into the thing, okay, is patient. You got to have patience with the athletes. At times, teaching them, they are not perfect. They will go wrong, and if you have the patience with them, you're out. Because at times, as I said before, they are kids. You got to have the patience. So take your time with them, and you'll get the results in time to come.
All right, that's so wonderful. Thank you, Mr. Ball, and congratulations.
And thank you very much. God bless.
First, let me say thank you, and it's an honor to be awarded. It's always lovely when you are appreciated, when you're appreciated by your peers. Well, I've always wanted to be I'm a teacher by profession and a coach also. I've always wanted to be a teacher. I'm just motivated to see the best out of the children, the athletes.
And being in what I consider to be a male-dominated profession, how do you feel to be among the awardees tonight as only female?
Well, actually it is a male-dominated profession, but we have several females out there, myself and others. We are trying our best. Sometimes it's difficult, but you know, if you're determined enough and you're focused enough, you will achieve whatever you put your mind to. For all those females out there who are considering coaching, I would tell them just go at it, because being a female coach, we have a soft side to us at sometimes, and sometimes you know you need to be a bit rough, and we also have that. We can wear both hats. We can be motherly towards the athletes as well as stern and disciplined. Sometimes it requires discipline to achieve your goals and focus. So you just have to be the person that the athlete need at the present times. Sometimes it's not about physical abilities. It's also motivating athletes and getting them prepared mentally, because that's like 50% of the task, being prepared mentally as well as physically. Yes. Well, I've had several memorable moments in netball and as well as track and field. When I guess this year was the most memorable one. My primary school, St. Patrick's, we were crowned Kingston and St. Andrew netball champions. And then we went on to play in the All-Ireland Finals, where we won the All-Ireland competition also. It was just lovely seeing the look on the girls' face. They were so happy. And I know that we had to really fight and really work hard to get that title. And I'm happy for it, and the girls also. Well, I'm very pleased and happy about the direction that the coaching profession is heading. Firstly, we have a group of coaches gathered here today, being awarded and acknowledged for all their hard work and sacrifices. And as I said earlier, it's always lovely to be appreciated. So I know that my fellow coaches here, they are happy knowing that someone out there is acknowledging the work that they have been putting in over the years, and that persons out there are looking on and appreciating their hard work and effort.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
You're most welcome, and congratulations again.
Thank you.
All right, as the interviews continue with Danielle on the YouTube stream, we are going to be treated to some music. I hope you're enjoying your meal so far. And now it's about to get better, because we have a beautiful Jamaican black woman who's going to be bringing you some beautiful music. So give it up for the musical stylings of Althea Hewitt. Copper man, what's that?
Thank you, thank you. Good evening, everybody. How is everybody doing? Everybody all right?
Yeah.
Well, the food has come, so no soon more than all right. So, yeah, it's so nice to be here. Just waiting for the music to start. Althea Hewitt, been singing for quite a time. that music list to turn up, because it's been my recent number one hit in New York. So let me sing it for you. The school girl day, telling tales and biting nails, our goal. Can the music come up a little bit more? But in my mind, I know they will still live on and on. But how do you thank someone who has taken you from crayons to perfume? It isn't easy, but I try. Well, if you won't ever sky, I would ride across the sky in letters that would soar 1,000 feet high to serve with the love. Yeah. The time has come for closing books, and no glass notes must end. By the way, it's a classic, right? And as I leave, naturally, man, I know that I am leaving my best friend. Oh, someone who stopped me right from wrong and weak from strong. That's a lot to learn, don't it, girl? What can I give you in return? If you wanted the moon, I will try to make a start. Cause I would rather let you give my heart to serve with love. Yeah. For all those who are getting awards tonight, I just want to say congratulations to you. Thank you. So, yeah, yes. It's because I can't see the engineer or anything. So I have to sing these songs for you wonderful awardees here tonight. Enjoy it, okay? I call you, I need you. My heart's on fire. Hey, come to me, come to me, wild and wilder. Will you come to me? Lord, give me everything I need. Those who are not eating, everybody, sing along. You're simply the best, yeah. Better than all the rest, if you can sing. Better than anyone, anyone I ever met. I'm stuck on your heart, yeah. Tear us apart, that will never happen. Oh, I would rather be dead. In your arms, I see the start of every night and every day. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. In your eyes,
to get lost, washed away. Emmanuel, what thing I eat? Just as long as I'm here in your arms, I can be in no better place. Why, you're simply the best of the awardees tonight. Better than all the rest. Oh, better than anyone. Oh, anyone I've ever met. I'm stuck on your heart. Hang on every word you say. Ooh, tear us apart. Oh, said I would rather be dead, mommy, mommy. Oh, which of you leave me after losing control? Walking away with my heart, my soul. I can feel you weaving when I'm alone. Oh, baby, don't let me go.
How's the food? It's good. Not excellent, it's good. Enjoy.
You're the best, yeah. Wow, better than all the rest. All the awardees tonight, you're better than anyone. Anyone I ever, ever, ever met. Stuck on your heart, yeah, yeah. Hang on every word you say. Tear us apart. I said, I would rather be dead. You're the best, yeah. You're the best, yeah. You're the best, yeah. You're the best, yeah.
Thank you. You have yourselves a wonderful night. Thank you.
Who's the best? I would like to invite. You want more? Wow. I enjoyed that as well, so thank you. I would like to invite Mr. Reed again. And I know we just had the entertainment and the vibes and the dance, so I have to ask you first, can you dance?
Well, I danced all well for my wife, not for public, so she's the best judge of that.
Because nowadays, you know, when you're a coach, you have to be able to bust some of those dance moves, you know.
Well, for mimicry, yes, for my athletes.
Yes, for the athletes, and I got super excited when I saw you step in this evening, because if you don't know, I'm from Portland, and this man is from Portland as well, and you know, so many athletes in our parish, in the parish of Portland, have passed through your hands, and you've had that opportunity to develop so many athletes coming out of that parish single-handedly. You know, and to be recognized by your peers tonight, what does that contribution mean to you?
Well, very much. Miss Dowie, you're one of those, I must say. And I just want to use this opportunity to say thanks to Coach Riley and the organization. Being recognized, I've been recognized various times, but it's the first as a coach. And it is awesome, overwhelming, and it has been a long journey, 26 years, and when I was reflecting, when Coach Dyke was speaking, I said to myself that those 26 years, or these 26 years, it's one of relationship with various stakeholders. And it couldn't have been me alone. I have to give thanks for all those stakeholders, and most of all, my family. My wife is here tonight, and she has been right through those 26 years. And I also heard one of the other persons, well, the guest speaker, Dr. Orton, mention about the embarrassment that is a part of a package, and the heartache that a coach can go through. And many of us can testify and attest to that. But guess what? The passion and the love for children, I think that, and for those coaches who coach adults, the passion and the love for people is what propels us.
Thank you. You said a whole lot there, and I really feel some of that. And in fact, knowing personally the impact that you've had, and to see you being recognized by your peers, it feels really good. I want to ask, you know, in terms of the profession of coaching, are you pleased with your contribution and where you see coaching heading?
I'm very much, because when I started in 1998, I would say that we didn't have so many coaches that are knowledgeable and qualified, and we have seen that evolve. I want to say thanks to GC Foster College, my alma mater, and also to the J3s who allow coaches to develop themselves and to get that exposure. And I think Jamaica is in a good place. I am satisfied to see where it is at the moment.
And finally, what would you say to a youngster coming into the profession, especially when they may not have all the resources to get what they want done, and they have to make it out of whatever they can find? What advice would you give them?
The main advice that jumps out at me is that you have to love what you are doing, and you have to love people. If you don't know, I can tell you, coaching is a poor man's job. Even though I don't think no organization or no institution could fully pay a coach to coach a charge. I heard the great Mr. Dyke also said that to be a father, many times a nurse, physiotherapist, and many other things. At the primary school level, when you take them out, and when you take them back, sometimes you are expecting parents to receive them. That doesn't happen. You have to find more than one children's home. And it goes up to the high school level, because I have some experience there. And you have to also be a counselor, counseling not only the students, parents too. So it's a job that if the young coaches are coming in expecting a bed of roses and everything to be easy, is a wrong job.
All right, and I just want to say congratulations to you, Mr. Reed. And I'd like everybody to know that when I was in primary school and starting out, just loving to run at sports day, this man here is the one that took me to my first real track meet. So thank you for that, and thank you for being a part of my journey also. And congratulations again.
Thank you for having me.
All right, at this time, I would like to invite one of our lifetime awardees to the hot seat, I guess. It's not so hot, it's supposed to be mildly warm at this point. Mr. Messias. Lifetime awardee, as you make your way up to me, I would just like to remind you guys that is for over 40 years of coaching. And though we don't see any whistles tonight, any cones or any of that, it's a different occasion. So welcome, Mr. Messias. Just 40 years, four decades. A lot of experience that I can imagine. What has that been like for you, sir?
Well, yes, it started back in 1979. Yeah, it started back in 1979. It's a long, hard journey, a lot of challenges, but I made it.
Yes, you have. And I imagine that in 40 years, there have been lots of memories and moments that you reflect on. And I want you to tell me, you know, tell me about a time that you can never forget, that you'll never forget. In those 40 years, what is, when you think of, when you reflect on those 40 years, what's the first memory that comes to your mind when it comes on to coaching?
Well, the first memory came to mind is Mr. Nevermind, now deceased. While I was in high school, he saw me and was apparently going the wrong way. And he tried to get me on the right track. And from there, this is it. He guide me, he mentor me. You know, you see me as a son, you see me as a brother. And you know, I remember moments back in 1977. We have a young man by the name of James Robinson at Tivoli Gardens High School. That's where I started. You know, when he was running the 1500 meters, and about 50 meters to go, he turned around and called the athlete behind him, because the person beat him in the semifinals. And that was a memorable moment. It wasn't the right thing to do, but that was one of the most memorable moments.
Thank you for that. And I know oftentimes when you think about teams, we don't really think about coaches as being a part of the team. But when you really look at the how the coaching staffs are set up, you have to be a team player. So what have you learned over the years in terms of working with other coaches to get the result that you all want from your athletes?
Well, to be a good coach, you have to be a team player. All of us have to be working, you know, for one aim, going in one direction. Sometimes, you know, you might not be doing the right thing, but someone is there to guide you. And likewise, someone is not going the right way, and you are there to guide them. Yeah, but I'm always a team player.
All right, and lastly, would your athletes describe you as, what kind of coach would they describe you as?
I am stern, I'm strict. I'm a no-nonsense coach. I love the athletes. They see me as a father, as a teacher, as a mentor. Basically, that's it, yeah.
Thank you so much, Earl Messias, a lifetime awardee tonight, 40 years. Thank you. Congratulations. And at this time, we'll take a break. Okay, at this time we'll be going to the awards.
Thank you.
the silver awardees. That's for coaching for between 20 and 25 years of dedicated service. Let's start with the Queen, Licia Walters. Please give it up for Licia. She has had a fulfilling career at the primary school level, making her mark at St. Patrick's Primary, which still applies for trade. Lawson Brown. No? at Titchfield High since 2016 and won the boys section of Eastern Champs this year. Herman Reed, the Track and Field Coaches Association, honors you. Michael Dye, from middle distance runner to champion maker. Today, we recognize Mr. Michael Dyke's integral role as head coach at Edwin Allen High, a dominant force in girls' athletics since 2014. Dyke, an alumnus, has formed a history in girls' track and fields for Edwin Allen, making them synonymous with champions. Several former students of Edwin Allen have gone on to become professional track and field coaches, a testament to Dyke's inspirational coaches' abilities. At this time, the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors you, Coach Dyke. I think we're going to keep it. Should I keep it? Okay, Dr. Hawk, your duties. Invite our guest speaker, Dr. Gregory Horton. I'm sorry some of you came late and missed his very powerful address. We now welcome him back to the stage as we hand out to our platinum awardees for 30 to 35 years of dedicated service in coaching. Fitzroy Ball. He has planted his roots at the grassroots level with decades of involvement in coaching track and field at the primary school level, particularly Harborview Primary. So much so that he was there in the early stages of primary champs and has helped to shape that meet to what it is today. A man of many hats and a coach of many sports, including, listen to this, baseball, basketball, cricket, football, rugby, and lawn tennis, just to name a few. Certainly no surprise there for a man whose surname is Ball. With the limited resources, he has provided his athletes with avenues to express themselves, sometimes at his own expense. Mr. Ball, your exploits and service have not gone unnoticed. On this day and at this time, the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors you, Coach Ball. Coach Paul Francis is absent, but we'd like to still recognize him, a Woolmer's old boy. Paul started his coaching career there just out of high school. He co-founded MVP with his brother in September 1999 and has since distinguished himself nationally and internationally as an excellent coach and sports administrator. Paul was appointed head coach at MVP in 2017 and has represented the nation at the highest levels as coach. His touch is evident in the many achievements of the MVP athletes in various international competitions. And on this day and at this time, the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors Coach Paul Francis. Richard Thomas, Tomo, as he's affectionately called, is a better than average mathematics teacher and lecturer. With a seemingly never-ending supply of purple garb, he may be found most times at his favorite place, Kingston College. Since 1990, Thomas has been integral in KC's relay successes and has been a volunteer for decades. He epitomizes dependability and always strives to bring out the best in his charges. And so on this day, at this time, the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors Coach Richard Thomas. H. Michael Vassell, dedicated and inspirational. Coach Vassell has transformed athletes' lives through a relentless commitment to excellence. With over 30 years of coaching experience, his expertise has cultivated countless success stories at the national and international levels. His work with student athletes at Kingston College, the Manning School, St. Hugh's Sacer, Immaculate Conception, Woolmer's Boys, and Excelsior High has allowed him to foster not only physical prowess, but also instill invaluable life skills such as discipline, teamwork, and resilience. A true mentor and a motivator, Coach Vassa is often referred to as the father of throws due to his pioneering work with throws only meets. And so on this day and at this time, the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors you, Coach Vassa. Okay, we're going to ask Dr. Horton to stay with us a little longer.
Don't run away from me.
These are the Lifetime Achievement Awardees for over 40 years. A lifetime of distinguished and dedicated service in coaching and molding young lives. Though not here, Coach Michael Clark, we invite Nicola Guy. Coach Michael Clark could easily be inducted as the most successful high school coach in Jamaica's history. Michael Clark's coaching acumen and attention to detail has produced boys' championship titles for St. Jago, Jamaica College, and Calabar. He has high school world records for the 4x100 and the 4x400 with super teams from Calabar. Legions of coaches have been guided by him through G.C. Foster College, where he tutored as well. In addition, Coach Clark provided the foundation for many Olympic medal winners, including Warren Ware and Javon Francis. So on this day and at this time, the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors Coach Michael Clark, who is currently overseas, and so Coach Nicola Guy, one of his mentees, has received his award. Please give it. He says thanks. Tell him he's welcome and congratulations. Patrick Johnson. Sir Jono has coached the middle and long distance programs for Excelsior High School and Community College in recent times, achieving numerous success in meets and relays. Prior to this, he had successes coaching athletes at Edith Dalton James High and the Edith Dalton Blazers Track Club, St. George's College, Calabar, Ferncourt High, and was the head coach at St. Andrew Parish Teams. Johnson also took athletes to the Northwest Miami Classics, where they won numerous medals and awards. He has coached vertical jumpers as well, helping them to reach their respective finals at champs and setting a national age group record in the process. He has also served as the sports coordinator at Michael College and coach at Windward Road All Age. And on this day, at this time, the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors Coach Patrick Johnson. Congratulations. Errol Masias. Jatafka salutes Errol Masias, whose tireless work at Calabar has laid the basis for Jamaican success in the middle distance events. With the legendary team of Kimar Farquharson, Kevroy Venson, Javante Williams and Rivaldo Marshall, a super team, which set admirable 4x800-meter records at the Penn Relays and the Gibson McCook Relays. The Tivoli Gardens High and G.C. Foster College graduate has done his fair share of development and has impacted many young lives in a deliberate manner. As unassuming as he is, on this day, at this time, the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors you, Coach Errol Masias. And even though he's also not here overseas, the legendary Coach Stephen Frano Francis. A trained accountant, Stephen Vincent Francis has amassed a brilliant portfolio of international coaching success. Growing from his initial base at Woolmer's Boys, we salute him for his foresight and an adventure in taking the road less traveled by being among the first to encourage young athletes to stay home in Jamaica and train. In particular, we celebrate his key role in the formation of the World Athletics Club of the Year, the MVP Track and Field Club, which has become a model to so many here and abroad. With his consistent productivity and a bandwidth that ranges from excellence in the sprints and hurdles to the jumps and the throws, the club has more than 25 Olympic medals and over 71 World Championship medals, an achievement that almost seems unrivaled. And so on this day and at this time, the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors Coach Stephen Francis, who is also being presented with the Hector Smith Master Coach Award, named after track and field coaching legends Edward Hector and Eldemiah Smith, who both passed away earlier this year. They served as executive members of JATAFCA and have distinguished themselves as coaches, and especially with results in the discipline of middle and long distance. This award is for quality of work, and today we present it in its absence to Coach Stephen Frano Francis. That's it. Thank you very much, Dr. Houghton. Give it up for all the awardees. I've always said that I could never be a coach, don't have the patience. So we congratulate you for your work. David, I cannot read your lips. Oh, that's Mr. Coach Michael. Better late than never, they say. So let's invite the silver in the silver category. Why I can't find it. Here we are. Okay, because I was looking for the wrong name, because I'm actually named God's Fight. Okay. All right. So I read it. I'm going to read it again. God Smythe, a G.C. Foster graduate, makes his impact in the Western region. He has had a long and distinguished career at Mushet High School, where he's guided many careers and shaped many young lives. If you need an example of passion and commitment, it is God Smythe. The Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association honors you, Coach Smythe. Thank you very much. All right, and now we invite the president of the Jamaica Track and Field Coaches Association, Coach David Riley, to bring us the vote of thanks. Coach Riley.
Thank you, Karen. Good evening, everyone. All the distinguished guests and fellow colleagues who are here, who've been recipients of the awards tonight, let me express my congratulations to you all. Just want to say thanks to you for your continued service. And the more we, as an association, take the time to honor our coaches, the more we realize how many others need to be honored. And since the nominations open, and I must tell you the process is that it's a peer nomination. So fellow coaches nominate the coaches, and then there's a committee that selects the persons who are to be presented, and want to thank Hubert Lawrence, who chairs that committee. And so it is based on nominations. So it's not the executive of the association that chooses who is honored. But when the nominations are open, usually in September, members will submit nominations, and then those are sorted and reviewed and then selected. And it's very interesting. We've been getting calls from all over, and I realize how many persons have never been recognized for the effort, and hopefully we can, you know, get to everybody before we talk about them posthumously. And, you know, remember even Edward Hector, and Elmer Smith. They've done so, these guys used to compete so fiercely with each other, and they sit beside each other coaching their athletes. It's amazing to see to see them. They're sitting beside each other in the bleachers and shouting at different athletes, racing against each other. And so it's a great rivalry, great friendship, and they did very well in terms of the production. But we want to express our thanks as an association to the many persons who've joined us in making this possible. We want to thank all the entities, J3A, for doing for us what I guess the J3A thinks is very important. And we thank the president for being here as well, the Ministry of Culture, Gender, Entertainment and Sports, for their assistance through the SDF, World Class Athletes Management Group. We also want to thank the want to thank PA Benjamin for also coming on board and helping us. Puma, a big sponsor for our event here tonight. And of course, the Terranova Hotel for their assistance and their sponsorship tonight. We do have a special award that we want to present to one of our recipients tonight. And there's no real reason other than the fact that she's the only female. So I'm gonna ask Leisha to come. And courtesy of Sandals International, a weekend for two at Sandals. And so we also want to thank Sandals for donating. We're hoping to have gotten enough for everybody, but of course that was up to me. So, Leisha, let me, congratulations. We'll give you the envelope right after. But you can send us pictures. Or not. So again, I want to thank you all for taking the time and coming. And for those who are watching online, and we certainly appreciate the support, and we look forward to continuing this as an annual event, and certainly we're looking forward to our coaches being even more motivated and helping Jamaica to get to the top of the medal podium in all international championships. I think we can, and I think we will. Thank you. The baskets are actually for the lifetime awardees, so maybe they should come and receive. And then folks will have some photos right after as well. So the lifetime awardees, baskets courtesy of PA Benjamin. Yes, so they can come and receive them.
All right, so the Lifetime Achievement Awardees, Michael Clark, of course, not here. Stephen Francis, not here. Then Patrick Johnson and Errol Messias. I'm sure Coach Riley will arrange for those baskets to reach the other two. Applause. Outstanding service. A proud country is truly grateful. Once the photographer is done, you're done? All right, thank you. Give it up again for all the awardees, and for the lifetime awardees, and for the single woman who gets to, you know, do our thing at Sandals. Don't send them no pictures. Enjoy it. You deserve it. And so, ladies and gentlemen, the only final business I have here is to bring you some, just a few closing remarks. As I said before, I'm sorry that some persons missed Dr. Horton's address, but I would also like to endorse everything that he said. And I can think of very few awards that are as satisfying as being being recognized by your peers. And I would like to add my own congratulations to the coaches that were honored tonight. Our country owes you a tremendous debt of gratitude. As you celebrate your success and learn from your failures, I urge you to take note of everything Dr. Horton said, and especially those coaching children and young children and young people, be always mindful of the awesome responsibilities you have. You are doing God's work. In many cases, you are the only positive role model or father figure, and you heard from Dr. Horton himself, that many athletes have. Never forget that your words and your actions will impact their lives positively or negatively. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your time. Thank you to those here at Terra Nova. Thank you for those who joined us on the YouTube stream. Good evening and good night.